Good afternoon.
Hello.
My name is Kyle Ritter, and I'm canon for music here at the Cathedral of All Souls, and it's my enormous pleasure to welcome you to this concert this afternoon of Cameron Aiken and Bob Brewer. One does not get to hear an entire song cycle like Winterreise often. As a matter of fact, I heard this piece one other time about 33 years ago when I was in graduate school, and so this is a real opportunity. Great experience that we will have this afternoon here at Cameron Singing's beautiful music. He is accompanied by Bob Brewer. As the world gets smaller and smaller, Bob and I were in graduate school together one of those 33 years ago. And you're in for an equal treat hearing him accompany these pieces. Please know that this concert is free, but we are collecting an offering for Episcopal Relief and Development response to Ukraine. And so there is a basket back there that will gladly accept your check or cash. If you wish to do that, we'll send it directly to ERD for that relief and development. So without any further ado, please welcome Cameron Aiken and Bob Brewer.
Piece of work, and so I'm going to try to give you some little insights along the way that might help you just get more out of it on the first hearing. So first of all, thanks to everybody for coming and not being out in the mountains today. The rain has helped with some of that. But Wilhelm Mueller was the poet for both of Schubert's big song cycles, Die Schöne Müllerin and Winterreise. And if you can glean, I think, one thing about him from those works, it would be that he does not take breakups well. So in Die Schöne Müllerin, for the first cycle that Schubert says, it's a 20-song cycle. There's about 10 excited, happy songs where he's meeting the girl and all that, and then things start to go off the rail. And by the 20th song, the last song in the cycle, it's the river is singing a lullaby to him as he sleeps in the bottom of it. So the good news of Winterreise is that at the end of this, our narrator is still alive. The bad news is he gets dumped before the first song ever begins. So there's no happiness in this cycle. He's pretty much walking through the German frozen winter, just kind of contemplating his life and his existence and his solitude and contemplating whether death is in his early is coming up on him. So as a poet, Mueller was maybe not the best. He might not be remembered today had it not been for Schubert's settings of these songs. Schubert, though, found a lot of inspiration in them, and especially in Winterreise, it was one of the last things that he composed before he died at the age of 31. So he was young, and he knew that he was dying, and there's just a lot to contemplate for someone in that position. And like Mozart before him, he kind of found his most profound voice in the writing of this music just before he died. And as a matter of fact, editing these pieces for publishing was one of the last things that he did that he finished up right before he died. So he kind of takes the poetry to a new level, and he really surpasses all of his other work. And I think in part he does that because this work, you'll find, has a lot of space in it. There's some virtuosic parts for the piano, but there's also, I would say, five or six songs that I can almost play on the piano, which is saying that it's pretty easy. From a technical perspective of the notes, there are other pieces that only someone like Bob can play, and I'm fortunate to have him. But for that reason, I think because of that spaciousness and what needs to be brought to it, younger singers don't tend to sing this repertoire very, very much. It tends to be something that you move into once you're sort of a more mature singer. So anyway, to help get us through this, because it is thick, and especially for a English-speaking audience who may not have heard it before, what I'm going to do, we're going to break this into four sections. I'll probably take a little break and maybe walk off between each section and give you a little intermission in the middle. Before each section, I'm going to take just about three or four of the songs and give you just a little nugget of something to hang on to as you hear them. So we're going to start with number one, Gute Nacht, which is Good Night, which kind of sets up, you'll hear these pulsing eighth notes, which sets up the walking that the narrator starts on. And you'll hear that return throughout the piece, particularly like in number 10 and number 20. Those eighth notes will tend to come back, but they sort of get more menacing as the piece goes on. A lot of what he does is sort of the narrator, the vocalist, is inside his head, whereas the pianist is sort of the whole rest of the painting. So all the scenery is sort of created through the piano. So as we move through number two, Yvetterfana is the weather vane, and he's complaining that this girl who just dumped him, is basically like the weather vane, just spins whichever way the wind turns. And you'll hear that wind really blowing around through the piano part. Number five, the Lindenbaum, the linden tree, you'll similarly hear the wind, but this time you kind of hear it rustling through the trees, all through the piano. The tune for that one is actually very simple, and the piano is just an amazing sort of masterpiece of piano writing that creates the rest of the scenery there. And then number seven, I'll point out, maybe my favorite piece in the whole thing. He sort of encompasses all the emotion of the whole piece. I feel like in that one, it starts out with him talking about how the river has gotten frozen over and how it's solid and still on the top. And then there's a second section where he sort of goes back and reflects on happy memories, and it's one of about three happy pages in the whole piece. And then there's a moment of stillness, a pretty profound stillness. And then the next section, he compares his heart to the river, where it's frozen on the top, but then underneath there's a raging current. And the way he builds, he sort of has a real push and pull between this sort of deadpan approach and then getting rushed into the emotional current of everything that he's trying to express. So to me, that's one of the biggest masterpieces that Schubert composed. So anyway, with that, it's a long thing, so we'll get going, and I hope you enjoy it.
Sie wirft den armen Flüchtling aus. Er sehr bemerkt entzollen, des Haus gesteckt erschielt, so hätt niemals suchen wollen, im Haus ein treues Frauenbild. Ihr Wind drinnen mit den Herzen wie auf dem Tor.
Mit meinen heißen Tränen.
Yeah.
Thank you. Und Nacht, die kam ins Freit, die runden Linden.
Haken die Dank mit ich noch einmal rückwärts sehen. Möcht ich zurück wieder erwarten, vor ihrem Hause stille stehen. Könnt mir der Tag mit die Gedanken, möcht ich noch einmal rückwärts sehen. Möcht ich zurück wieder erwarten, vor ihrem Hause stille stehen. Möcht ich zurück wieder erwarten, vor ihrem Hause stille stehen. Vor ihrem Hause stille
So this section starts with a tune called Irdish, which is a will-o'-the-wisp, which I had to look up exactly what a will-o'-the-wisp was, but it's basically a mythical light out in the wilderness that that draws people off their course, basically, and gets them lost, supposed to be lost souls and that kind of thing. Actually, if you look on the Wikipedia website at what a will-o'-the-wisp was, which was what I did, it'll list several places around that are links to other Wikipedia pages where mysterious lights are supposed to be. One of which is apparently Brown Mountain near Morganton. So you go out there and search for that. But you'll hear the flickering lights in both the accompaniment and the voice on that one. Rest is where he's finding a place to rest. For the night, and you'll hear those sort of more menacing footsteps sort of haunting him during that one. And then the next one, he falls asleep and he's having he's dreaming about happy stuff with the girl, and then every time he wakes up, he realizes that he's right back in the middle of the wilderness. So that one goes through a whirlwind of emotions there. And then the last one I'll just point out is Die Post, which will be right before the intermission, and you'll hear in the accompaniment and all that, the mail carrier coming through, and the narrator gets all excited because he hears the postal carrier, but then he says, well, I know nothing's going to be brought to me, so I don't know why I'm getting so excited.
Das ihr Reich.
Thank you.
sie war grün im Mai. Ich träumte von grünen Wiesen, von lustigem Vogelschrei, von lustigem Vogelschrei. Und als die Hähne krähten, da war es mein Auge war, da war es kalt und finster, und schrien die Raben von Tag.
Herz auf Ohr,
So in this section, we've got, I'll just skip to too. The Crow has just a gorgeous accompaniment, and you'll hear these crows. They sound more like vultures to me, but they're circling overhead, and he thinks they're following him to make prey on him, because he assumes that he's close to the end, which turns out probably not to be true. Last Hope. That's a pretty bizarre composition to me. It sounds like one that could have been composed a good number of years after it was. But he, in a very romantic 19th century way, pins his last hope on this last remaining leaf on a tree, and then the leaf falls off the tree. Endorfa is one of my favorite ones in the village, because it really has this strange dichotomy between the piano and the voice, where he's talking about he can hear the sounds from the village where the dogs are rattling on their chains and barking at night, and everybody else is asleep and dreaming of happy things, but he's off away from that, so you're hearing that sort of chaos in the distance, where he's very melancholy in the foreground. And so the piano and the voice play off of each other in a very interesting way. I don't know another piece like it. And then the illusion, is basically a Viennese waltz. She comes from Vienna, so this is basically a Viennese waltz, but it's kind of taken off the rails, and he sees another light, which he thinks is of a house, and he dreams of warmth and comfort and all that kind of stuff, but then he says, no, that's not going to be, that's just an illusion. So. Thank you.
Wonderful. des Himmels graues Kreuz, die Wolken fetz ein Flott, und im Atemstreit, und im Atemstreit. Und rollt Feuerflammen, ziehen zwischen ihnen hin, das nenn ich einen Morgen, so recht aus meinen Sinn. Mein Herz ist an dem Himmel, gemalt sein eigenes Bild. Es ist nicht aus der Winter, es ist nicht aus der Winter kalt und wild.
Then the last song, It's really an amazing ending to this thing. He comes across the first person that he sees on the whole journey, which is this essentially a beggar guy. He's sitting out on the ice on the edge of town. He's barefoot and playing a hurdy-gurdy, which is basically a grinding organ. It doesn't take any real talent or skill to play it. It's just sort of a drone, and you hear that drone on the piano, and you play little melodies. It probably has a pentatonic scale or something where there's no wrong notes, and so you just sort of play over that. So this beggar guy is sitting out on the ice, barefoot, playing that, and the dogs are sniffing at him, and nobody's paying any attention to him. There's nobody around. But I think to my reading of it, the narrator kind of sees like a kind of a Buddha type figure in this guy, and maybe a path to resolve his suffering and kind of enter back into some path. He's definitely nowhere close to at any sort of peace, and is basically he begs the organ grinder at the end of the song to please take him with him, and can he play his songs. So it's a very ambiguous ending that could lead in a good or bad direction for this guy. It's very understated and a really fascinating way to finish this off. So.
Was für ein Weib. Steht ein Leiermann.